Susie Homesteader of the Rockies, and welcome to the Susie Homesteader channel. And today we're out on a logging job, and we're going to talk about how to gather your own firewood in the event that you have a wood stove or some other way to burn firewood at your home. So I thought it'd be kind of a fun place to start on the logging job that we're on and talk about how somebody like you or me can go out and cut down some trees to bring them home. So, obviously one of the most important things you're going to have with you is a good, reliable pickup truck or some way to haul all your firewood back. Four-wheel drive is, you know, kind of the way to go, but depending on where you're getting your firewood will depend on what kind of a vehicle you're going to have to start with. up here in the Rockies, like I said, we're on a logging job here, far, far out in the woods. So, you know, we got to have a four-wheel drive pickup that's reliable and hopefully have a big enough bed to get as much firewood in it as we can, unless we have some kind of a trailer to pull some extra wood in with. So besides having a super reliable vehicle when you get up there in the woods, the second thing you're going to need is just some really good tools. And some of the tools you're going to have to start with is going to be a chainsaw. You might want to think about having more than one saw, just in the event that either you have somebody helping you, or, you know, you might get your bar pinched in a tree and then you're going to have to get a second saw to get your first saw out. So there's a couple different reasons to have more than one saw on the job. And this is an example of a couple different sizes of saws. You know, and in our case, we prefer steel saws and steel products, but, you know, there's Husqvarna and all kinds of great brands out there for cutting down your own trees. But, you know, they do come in all different sizes, depending on the size of the trees that you're cutting down, and or whether you're strong enough to run a saw this big. So, you know, in my case, I use something a little bit smaller. This is just a little 025. It's not going to cut down some big trees, but for somebody my size, you know, who wants to maybe work in the woods all day long, something small like this is probably going to be a little bit more efficient for me. Now, I can run a saw that's a little bigger, like an 034 or an 044, but that's going to wear me out real fast, and, you know, that'll work on some bigger trees, and maybe just, you know, for somebody with my upper body strength, I'm probably only going to make it like an hour or two with a saw this size before I'm exhausted. So for me, it's a little more beneficial for me to have a smaller saw that I can run longer and not get too wiped out on. So, you know, something like an 044 or this size saw is great for cutting down some bigger trees. and something like an 034 is good for after you've dropped trees on the ground or on your landing, something like this where you have all these trees cut up already. And maybe you're going to start cutting those into firewood lengths. So different saws for different sizes and different things you're going to do with them. And if you're going to go buy a brand new saw, you know, wherever you go buy that saw, they'll give you all that kind of information too. But if you're going to borrow a saw from somebody, you know, definitely make sure you can handle it. And again, you know, that might depend on whether you're a man or a woman or how big you are and how strong you are. But don't ever run a saw that you can't handle. I've done it and it's really dangerous, especially when they kick back. So lots to think about. Hopefully you can talk to a professional about what kind of a saw that you're either going to purchase or you're going to use. So there's your first most important tool, is your chainsaw. And then secondly, of course, you're going to need some saw gas. And again, wherever you decide to go buy your saw, they should explain to you the kind of gas you're going to use. And for a two-stroke engine, which is what these chainsaws are, you're going to want a mixed gas. And they will, somebody, like I said, that you know, knows what they're doing, should explain to you the ratio of the gas to oil mixture that you're going to need for your fuel. And then the second thing you're going to go through really fast is going to be a bar oil, a bar chain oil. And that's just to keep your chain lubricated. And you will go through that not as fast as your fuel, but that's the second most important thing you're going to want to have on you, so that you don't get out in the woods and not have the kind of stuff that you need, or, you know, have to go run all the way back to town to get something you're out of. So it's nice to have, you know, extra fuel, extra bar oil, you know, and I do have like a whole tool bag that I keep when I go out in the woods, full of all kinds of stuff, you know, funnels and you name it, just so that I'm never without a tool when I'm out there. But two of the tools that you're absolutely going to have is going to be a file, and that's going to be to file your chain, because that's going to get dull really fast. And that's something that you'll spend more time on than you think. And then the second tool that you're absolutely going to have is just a bar wrench, and that's to tighten your chain and anything else that comes up on your saw. So bar wrench and a file, two tools you're going to absolutely have to have when you're in the woods. And like I said, it's kind of a good idea to just go get an old tool bag and have all the things you need in it, so that you just don't have to keep losing time trying to get back to the tools that, you know, you left behind. So anyway, there's a couple good ideas for you for saws and tools that you got to have. And then the second most important group of materials that you want to have on the job is going to be your safety gear. Now, I'm not actually going to cut down one of these trees today. I'm going to have somebody else do that for us today. But I will tell you, make sure you have a pair of chaps. I have cut my knee, sliced my knee right open without a pair of chaps, running a saw when my arms got tired. And you also want a pair of steel toe boots in case for some reason you drop that saw anywhere near your feet or anything else falls on your feet. So there's two important safety gear items you want to have. A hard hat is super important, just in case something hits you in the head. And even a pair of safety glasses are kind of nice to have. And that's just because all kinds of stuff flies into your eyes, you know, sawdust and pine chips and you name it. And I have to say, out of all the issues I've probably had cutting down trees, most of it just has to do with getting stuff in my eyes. So that's another thing you want to have. And then a pair of gloves. It is a little tricky to hang on to a saw handle with a slippery pair of gloves, but if you can get a pair of gloves that have some kind of like a little rubber grip to it, that helps out too, because you definitely don't want to let this, you know, out of your hands. So whatever gloves you pick, make sure they have a really good grip on them. And then, you know, just obviously the rest of it's going to be common sense with safety and being careful. So we're going to go over to an area where we'll actually cut down a tree. But the first thing we're going to do is kind of assess the area that tree is in before we even start cutting. And then I'll kind of help you guys step by step go through how to actually drop a tree or fell a tree.
Kind of that way.
Okay, so we're going to pick a couple of trees here to drop today. And I'm here with Joe from Bear Creek Excavating out here in the Rockies. And he's a fourth generation logger, so I think we have an expert here today. And then we'll cut down a second tree too, just to give you an example of how some of these trees are leaning. So one of the most important aspects of starting to cut down your firewood is picking the areas that you're going to cut these trees down. And Joey's going to tell us a little bit more about looking for the kind of an area that you want to start in. Obviously, we know you want to pick the most open areas you can.
That's
to
right.
Start cutting your trees, right?
Yes.
Okay, so what happens if you don't have an open area to start cutting?
Well, then it could get real dangerous. You know, you want to look up at your tree.
Uh-huh.
Make sure there ain't nothing in it that can come down and hit you.
Uh-huh.
And just pick a good open spot to put your tree.
Okay. If what happens, like, if you're on a hillside and you have just rows of trees, are you going to start at the top of that hill, or are you going to, you know, start down at the bottom and start kind of working your way down?
Typically, we start at the top and work our strip down.
Okay.
That way, we're always tipping trees uphill.
Okay. And then I'm guessing, obviously, you guys are going to look at the top of the tree first, right?
That's
because
correct.
That's going to determine which direction that tree is going to lean.
That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah, you walk up to it, you assess it.
Uh-huh.
You kind of look at it and see where it wants to go.
Uh-huh.
And then you put it where it wants to go, pretty much.
Okay. So in the top of that tree, what we're calling that is just the crown, and that's where the bulk of the weight is going to start with where it's going to land.
That's correct.
Okay.
With all the limbs in it up there, yep.
Okay. So if you have a kind of a tree that's not leaning, you're not that worried about what direction it's going to go. But if you do have a tree that's really leaning, what would you do in a case like that?
Well, then we'd use a wedge.
Okay.
You know, we wedge them over there.
Uh-huh. Okay, and today, the tree that we picked, you don't think we need a wedge, so...
I don't think we need a wedge on this one.
Okay. And we have a nice open spot, so hopefully it's going to land exactly where we plant it, so...
Well, we're hoping to put it straight down through there.
Okay. So, and then how high up on this tree would you start notching out your tree?
We try to keep ours closest to the ground as we can.
Okay. Now, if somebody wanted some of these stumps out... like just say on a different private job or a public job, and they want to take these stumps out with equipment after the trees are cut down, would the stumps be left higher?
Yes, they would. You would want to cut them higher. That way they got some leverage to grab
to push the stumps out.
Yeah.
Okay, so whether that's on private or public land, yeah. But if you're just getting firewood, you're going to cut that tree down as far as you can to the base?
I would, yes.
Yeah, okay, Alrighty, well, and then he's going to show us how to actually notch out a tree on the one side just to get it to lean in the right direction, and then you're going to do a back cut on it?
And then we'll do a back cut, and then we'll kind of watch it as it goes to make sure it's going where we want it.
Okay, so let's start with that. Let's start with our notch. So go ahead and show us how to notch out a tree for firewood.
Okay. What we're doing here is we cut halfway through the tree with our face cut, and then we're going to cut down on it like this here to put a little notch in here, and then we'll start on our back cut on this side.
Okay.
And see if it goes the way we want it to. Our notch right here that we took out of this tree. So we're hoping that it goes the way we got it notched. So we will see what happens here.
Geronimo! All right, nice. So what do we have left here on the base of the tree here? Is this kind of what's called the hinge, where it actually split?
Yeah, that's the hinge. This is where we cut it.
Okay.
And this is our back cut.
Okay.
And this is kind of the hinge.
Right, almost like a door.
Yeah.
Like the hinge of a door. And that's kind of what you're looking for, really. Just
that's
kind of
correct.
A nice flat stump with just whatever that little section was, that hinge it fell off of. Down a second tree here in a second with Joe, but let's talk about a couple of the dangers that a lot of people don't think about when they're cutting down trees. I'm gonna guess that on a windy day, that would be a bad idea.
Yeah, windy days are not good.
Okay.
The inside rotten trees are kind of bad too. They're unpredictable. You don't know which way they're going to sow you. So you kind of want to watch your sawdust as it's coming out of your saw to see if it's rotten wood or good solid wood.
And you're not going to know if it's rotten until you start cutting into it, right?
That's correct.
So what happens when you're like halfway through a tree and you see that it's rotten? You just, what are you going to do after
that?
Well,
then you pay extra attention to it and watch it.
Oh, okay.
Carefully.
Because you just, it's a little more unstable and you're not going to know which way it's going to fall?
That's correct.
Okay. Yes. All right. So the wind, obviously, being one of the big dangers. And then number two, rotten trees. And then what happens if your saw gets pinched? And then how would that get pinched?
Well,
your blade get pinched?
Your saw, when it gets pinched, is on your back cut.
Uh-huh.
You think the tree's going to go one way and it decides to fall back onto your saw.
Uh-huh.
So then your saw gets pinched.
Okay.
In there.
Yeah. And then what do you do?
And then you should always have a partner with you.
Right.
And then if he's got a saw, then you just go ahead and saw it the way it's leaning and let it go ahead and tip over.
Right. So another big important thing is don't be out in the woods by yourself.
That's correct. Yeah. You always want to have somebody with you when you're out in the woods.
Right.
Especially if you're sawing, sawing trees.
Yeah. So what's the word, the term widowmaker come from?
The widowmaker is a tree that you saw down and it leans up into another tree.
Uh-huh.
And then they used to go up there and fall that tree so they'd both fall all the way down to the ground.
Uh-huh.
And that's very dangerous because then you just don't know what's going to happen.
Because yet there's too many trees involved, basically.
Yeah, you got a leaning tree into another tree and you're trying to tip that tree over. And that's where the widowmaker comes from.
Okay. And then what's that other term? It's barber chaired. What is that? What's that mean?
Barber chair? When you have a back cut. Uh-huh. And the tree's leaning really hard, and you don't cut it fast enough, and it'll split the tree up like this. So the butt of this tree will come up into the air, ever how far.
Okay.
Which is nobody knows.
Right. So what's a good safe distance to stand once you know that tree's going to drop and you're good to go? What's a safe distance to stand away from the tree? Like 15, 20 feet?
Well, no, you can stand right up to the tree as long as you know where it's going.
Right.
So, if it's going to hit like a bank or something out there, and it could move over one way or the other, you kind of want to watch that before that.
Oh, okay.
You kind of assess that before you tip it over so you know which side of the tree to be on.
Okay. So, and then if you do have an area to move out of the way, would it be like within a 20-foot, 15-foot radius? Or?
Yeah, the closer you can stay by the tree and keep an eye on it, the safer you are.
Because you can see where it's actually going.
Once you leave and run away from the tree, you don't know what's going on.
Oh, okay. So if you're close enough to actually see the direction it's dropping, that's a better idea.
Yeah. Yeah. And keep an eye on it and see if it's going to bounce up or move on you or anything like that. But you want to stay pretty close to the tree. It's always a bad thing to run away from the tree.
Okay, because you might be running in the wrong direction.
Well, yeah, you could trip and fall, and then the tree lands on you anyway.
Oh, okay. Well, and then I guess that would be another safety concern, a big one, too, is just making sure there's not a bunch of debris from where you are.
Yeah,
because
you want to have a safe place, safe zone to go to.
Right, and then also have it somewhat clear around the trees so you're not going to trip or anything while you're cutting it.
Yeah, you want to always, limb up the trees, cut the underbrush around the trees so that you're not tripping or falling on anything.
Right. Okay, yeah, well, that sounds like some pretty serious concerns when you're cutting down a tree. Anything else you can think of, too, in terms of safety?
Well, the best thing to do is always look at your tree and just watch it, and make sure you got a safe place for it to fall.
Okay,
and then
good.
Always be out with another person.
Right, yeah, that's definitely important to have somebody there for you in case something goes wrong. All righty, well, we're going to cut down one more tree here. Just to give you, and this is a different, this is a larch.
This is a larch tree.
Yeah, okay. Is there a big difference between cutting down a pine and a larch, between the two?
Well, the pines typically, they're a pine wood, so yeah, there ain't much difference in it.
Uh-huh.
Except for the pine has more limbs on it, so you got to really pay attention to that.
Oh, okay.
The larch are pretty more, there ain't very many heavy limbs on it like a pine tree.
So you have a little better idea of which direction it's going to fall.
On large, yes.
Because there's not so much weight on the top.
Right.
As a
pine.
The
Douglas fir and the pine and all that have quite a few limbs on it, as you can see some of these trees.
Right. Okay.
And they go here and then,
Right.
So.
And then the bigger factor on what trees you're cutting down is really just going to be whether it's a green tree or a dead tree, right?
It depends on what you're cutting. You know, if you're out selective cutting like we are here, we take the bigger wood and try to leave all the regen to grow up.
Right. Okay. Alrighty, well, let's cut down one more tree here. This is going to be a larch we're going to cut, and we'll just watch this one drop and just kind of give you an idea of how to fell a tree again. So a couple other things we want to talk about too when you're cutting wood out in the forest there is just kind of the common obstacles that come up with your saw every day and the things that you wind up having to address the most with your chainsaw. So what are some of the things that come up with you guys like when you're on a job?
The most common is keeping your chain tight.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, because you don't want to run these very loose.
Uh-huh.
Otherwise they throw a chain off.
Okay.
And keeping it sharp, of course.
Right.
You know, we try to keep it out of the rocks and out of the dirt and stuff.
Okay.
As much as we can.
Right.
And then just make sure that you clean out your air filter and, you know, make sure you got it full of oil and gas.
Okay.
And the pole rope, you know, you always have to keep an eye on them because, as you can see, this one here needs a
It's missing
new one.
Missing
yes.
the rope
it's
there.
Missing a new one.
So it's real easy to just kind of yank your rope out.
Yeah, they break every now and then, and
okay.
You know, then you got to take this panel off right here and
okay.
Put a new pole rope in it.
So you always kind of want to have an extra rope as well as your tools.
Have an extra, yeah, rope, spark plugs, a bar and chain.
Okay.
Sometimes the tip can go out in them. They
uh-huh.
get burned out, especially if you run your chain too tight.
Right.
Your tip heats up, so
okay.
You don't want to over tighten your chain.
Because then they get stretched.
Yeah, and then it burns the tip out.
Okay.
So.
All right. So, and a lot of it's just kind of common sense, just taking care of it while you're running your saw, right?
Yeah, making sure you got your spark resistor on them and,
mm-hmm.
you know, your overall appearance of your saw should be something that you pay attention to when you fill mm-hmm. it up and maintain it.
Okay. And then obviously the more you use your saw, the more you kind of get an idea of how to keep it going longer.
Yeah, you need an act for the saw, you know, because every saw acts different.
Oh, okay.
So you kind of get to know the saw and how it runs. And
right. Kind of like any tool, just
yeah.
how to maintain it and how to keep it going as long as you can.
That's correct.
Yeah. Okay, and then are there any other times that you actually cannot run a saw when you're out in the woods or out in the forest during the year?
The only times you can't do it is on when the state has fire restrictions.
Okay, and fire restrictions for the state would generally be what? Like when it's the driest time of the year?
The driest, the hottest, depends on humidity.
Uh-huh.
You know, and how much dry stuff is out in the forest.
Okay, so and that's just common sense. You just want to be careful that you're not going to start any fires while you're out there, even if it's not a burn restriction
right,
time.
Right, yeah, no, you want to be careful out there.
Right. Okay, so anyways. Lots to think about with running a saw and getting your firewood and just trying to keep that wood stove burning when you need it. So we'll get to another logging job here when things warm up a little bit and it's not so muddy. And we'll talk about just some bigger aspects of wood and being out in the woods and just some other fun and interesting things that a lot of people might not know about logging. So we'll see you on another logging job. And if you have any questions, come see me on my website, Susie Homesteader of the Rockies, and we'll see you there. Bye-bye.
No, thanks, Joe.
Thanks.
Thanks so much.
So, let's get started. Subscribe to the Susie Homesteader channel, and we'll see you there. Bye-bye.